We start with a combination of the three first jewels of wisdom, reincarnation, karma, hierarchies. And after that, of course, the questions can come and the workshops. All people, at least at some point in their life, are looking for an answer to the questions and also the sorrows of human life. Many people have intuitions that all beings are interconnected, that our life has a meaning, and also that we have a free will and a kind of responsibility. But they often lack a philosophy of life that is of real and unremitting value during all the challenges of our daily life. In this lecture, we shall present and investigate three building blocks, you can say, of such a philosophy of life: reincarnation, karma, hierarchies. These jewels of wisdom are based on the three fundamental ideas mentioned by Hermann this morning, and which we called boundlessness, cyclic motion, and all beings are equal in essence, which is another way of saying the so above, so below. As already said, we present these ideas, of course, as hypotheses that you can, and to be honest, that you must investigate yourself. Do these jewels give explanations which are satisfying to your mind and heart? Then they are worthy to be applied in your life. One thing is sure. In the world, we find a really overwhelming variety of views on life and death, and the view we ourselves adopt has a large influence on our aims and our thoughts and our acts in our life, probably even more than we are aware of. That's why reincarnation will be the best starting point of our today's journey into the jewels of wisdom. Well, what is reincarnation? The word has become generally known, but still many people have only a vague idea of its meaning. If you look to the literal Latin meaning, it is simply becoming flesh again, or to say it better, living in a body of flesh again. It means that life after life, we are coming back to this earth to learn our lessons in bodies of flesh, and to further develop all the faculties which are still latent in us. Can you prove that reincarnation exists is an important first question. And we think that everyone can find that out for himself. Once you realize that reincarnation is no exception in nature, not something that appears out of the blue, but it is in fact one form of the universal law of cycles. We see cyclic motion everywhere in nature. Night and day, the four seasons of the year, of course, the 12-year solar cycle of sunspots. Yes, astronomers, modern astronomers, speak about the birth and the death of stars and about the generations of stars. Looking into our physical body, we see that all processes are cyclic, from our digestion to the electrical pulses of our nerve cells. And our scientists know that, looking into the atom, that subatomic particles are no solid tiny balls. No, each particle also has a wave character and sometimes behaves like a wave. Just to sum up, reincarnation is a cyclical process of living again and again in a body of flesh. And this leads us to the question: what is incarnating? What experiences all these phases of life and death, activity and rest again? At this point, we refer again to the introductory lecture of Hermann, in which you heard that life, or consciousness, is the force working behind all manifested things. Each being is a center of life, or consciousness, you may say, which, that center of life, is limitless in its core, because we are all children from the boundless. So it is consciousness that reincarnates. It is consciousness that is in the alternating state of active life and spiritual rest. And in the beautiful, symbolic language of the ancient religions, these cycles of consciousness are called the breathing out and breathing in of Brahman, the projection of consciousness into material existence, always followed by the orderly retracting into its spiritual source again. Or, if we may cite the Quran, to Allah we belong, and to Him is our return. Or we find in the Tao Te Ching, the returning is the movement of the Tao. This knowledge of reincarnation. We have also a little point. This knowledge of reincarnation brings us to the next question. What are we? What is man? And the next scheme may be of great help. This, here you see, the threefold division of man, it's only, in fact, one way to describe the several capacities or layers of human consciousness. This division is relatively well known, as we find it, for instance, in the sayings of the Apostle Paul, spirit, soul, and body. Well, let us have a look at it. You notice the vertical line, originating in universal unity. We human beings are a stream of consciousness, flowing forth or emanating from the universal unity. All things have spiritual roots, and men too. The highest and greatest circle, the white one, called spirit, is our core, our highest self. This is our permanent part. It carries all possibilities of the cosmos in itself. This spirit part sends a ray downwards, which forms a center of consciousness on a lower plane, and that is the mental plane. And that is our soul, our learning part, the part that improves itself, develops itself. We human beings are trying to develop our thinking with all its many possibilities and pitfalls. Lastly, the ray of consciousness brings forth our body, our most material part, although it is a living part too. It is the instrument that we of course need to function in this physical world. As we all know, our body is transitory as a unity. When we die, we draw back our consciousness, the stream of consciousness, to the inner planes, and so we release our grip on our body. And all entities that ensouled ourselves are freed, and they go their own way. As a coherent system, our body disintegrates. So, what is man? We are, in essence, a spiritual being, an everlasting, reincarnating being. And each incarnation, we build up a body. In us is a permanent and a temporary part. If we keep this in mind, when looking at our fellow men, life becomes a daily inspiration. A key to understand ourselves is the fact that our soul, our mind, can focus on all levels of our being, from the divine to the physical. And this is illustrated in the next scheme by seven thinking aspects at the right side. These thinking aspects, aspects of our soul, they vary from the most universal, inspiring one, and that is Atman, inspiration, or our sense of unity, the highest, to to the most limited one, although it is also necessary, Stula Sharira, the physical, that's the last one, our bodily thoughts and all aspects between. What we wish to show now in this lecture, because the next lecture will elaborate it, is that we are able to make our spirit parts the leading force in our life. Just by our thinking, the way we think, we can do that. Yeah. This fact gives us a clue to the question why so very few people are able to look back consciously, so fully awake, into their former lives. Yet it is possible to do it, but only if we live entirely in our permanent reincarnating part. Simply because in that reincarnating part, our remembrances from former lives are stored. But we dare say most people, and me included, are still living so much in their temporary part that we as yet have no conscious access to these remembrances. The next logical question may be, how does reincarnation work? What happens when we die? A natural event that all of us will experience, and indeed have experienced many times before. There is still much fear and a great uncertainty about what may happen to us after death in our generation. And the cause for this troublesome situation is a lack of knowledge about what we are. Yet, we can become utterly familiar with death if we would realize that death and sleep follow the same process. Sleep and death are brothers, the old Greek said. Or to say it in the words of the Christian apostle Paul, we die each day. And yes, that's true. While sleeping, we pass the same states of consciousness as during our death. And in the next scheme, this analogy is elaborated. What happens when we feel asleep? We are, as we said, a stream of consciousness stretching from the heart of the universe to the lowest material form, our outer body. And every night, this stream of consciousness of us retreats to the inner spheres, to the spiritual sphere, when we have a deep and good sleep. You temporarily let go of your attraction to the physical sphere. You lose the waking state of consciousness, and start to dream. And after a night's rest, you will slowly wake up. You pick up your daily thoughts again and start to become active in the physical world. So you make here the complete circle. And now what is death? You already know, it's a perfect sleep. The only difference is that you will change to a new body. So at this moment you also recollect your atoms of your body when you start again in the physical world. That's what we call born again. That's why also we call the process re-embodiment. But the process is the same. And during sleep we experience the things that made an impression on our minds during the last day or days. Our emotions or anxieties, our desires of all sorts, our ideals, and also our inspiring thoughts. During death, exactly the same happens. In both cases, when we are death, so we meet ourselves. Nothing strange or unfamiliar or unexpected. So dying and being born are the most natural processes we can imagine that we should not fear at all, as we do not fear falling asleep either, longing for a rest after a days of experiences. Now, we have this interesting advice of the sage Pythagoras from Greek. Do not start to sleep before you have gone over the day in thoughts and have drawn honest lessons from it. One of its golden rules. If you are not satisfied with some things you did, then decide to do it another way tomorrow, because these spiritual lessons will accompany you during your sleep and will be a real help during the following day. Even as you may have experienced, even in a turbulent environment during daily life, we can keep our consciousness focused on our ideals and insights. Well, that was sleep. But after dying, directly after our last heartbeat, something similar happens. And this very important phase in our dying process, we call our panoramic vision. What happens then? It is a review of our past incarnation, but from an enlightened standpoint, enlightened by our higher nature. We see, as a wonderful panorama of events, each thought, each experience we had, even from babyhood till our last breath, passing by. And even more important, we recognize cause and effect. We recognize the justice of what happened in our life. From this panoramic vision, we draw very important spiritual lessons that become part of our conscience. Conscience that we take with us in our next lives, so that these lessons may guide and lead us. Well, knowing that about the panoramic vision, that's why it's recommended to surround each dying person with a sphere of inner peace and calmness, with as little noise and emotions as possible. For these hours are, in a certain way, the most valuable hours of our life. So, we see there is a very close similarity between sleep and death. We call it a cycle, but in fact, it is no closed cycle. It is a spiral. Here we have the process again, and you can imagine it is really a cycle, a spiral. Because simply we learn each day. Of course, if we are ready and wishing to learn, it's our own free will. Now, I think that's no point with you. You all are open-minded people, not satisfied with your present thoughts. Otherwise, you would not be here at this convivium. Okay. The first jewel of wisdom points to the fact that each life is only one in a long series of lives, but it does not provide us with an answer to when and where do we incarnate? Why are we born in a specific family, in a specific culture? And the second jewel of wisdom gives us the key. And this jewel is generally known as the law of cause and effect, meaning that each cause leads to a result that is equivalent to its cause, similar in character and also similar in strength. This universal habit in nature is widely known today as the law of karma. It is the teaching that nothing happens randomly and without cause, but that the whole cosmos is ruled by inescapable law, by cause and effect. Karma is a Sanskrit word, just meaning action. All actions, and a thought or a feeling is also an action, will have their due effects, now or later, that will come back to its originator like a boomerang. And as the English saying runs, what goes around, comes around. The other side of the coin is, each event in our life, each situation, so also now we are sitting here, it's the same, can be traced back to causes that we generated ourselves, either in this life or in former lives. So when and where we incarnate is a matter of cause and effect. when we, human souls, come back to Earth, we wish to be reborn again, we will be automatically attracted to that period, to that culture, to that family, to that father and mother, which corresponds to our own character, as it gives us the optimal chances to express our own character. We are, without exception, drawn back to situations that are familiar to us, where we have sown causal seeds, and consequently, where we will have to harvest, nice or nasty. Our children, for instance, are our old colleagues, persons that we probably have met many, many times before, and perhaps they were then our parents, when they are now our children. That's all possible. Where are your proofs of karma, we sometimes hear? Well, very simple. Look around in the physical world, where all physical laws are based on the law of cause and effect. We are so used to rely on this law that we hardly think about it. Nobody is surprised that the effect of a tennis ball depends on the way you hit it back. Or when a big dumb dog jumps on you, you, of course, have more difficulty to keep standing than when a chihuahua jumps on your feet. But why should this relation be only valid in the physical world? Here it is. Why would a strong thought not have a larger mental impact than a weak, flitting thought? Why would a really inspiring idea not have a spiritual impact throughout the rest of your life and maybe the lives which follow? According to theosophy, karma works equally on all planes of the cosmos. So, all our thoughts and acts produce corresponding results. But as we all know, not always immediately. The results may appear in a split second, for instance, when you are steering your car, or they appear after centuries, as is the case with many reform movements in society. But the results will come. And here the jewel of reincarnation is just as necessary as the jewel of karma. We can only understand our present fate if we remember that our present life is only one step or phase in an unending development, an unending series of causes and effects. And that's why we can distinguish three kinds of karma. First, karma that we encounter now and that is produced in the past, in this or earlier incarnations. If we take the example of family life, we may think of the friendly or, in the unhappy case, the clashing and conflicting relations between brothers and sisters, or children and parents. They are all generated by former actions in the past. Secondly, second type of karma, karma that we produce now by our thinking and behavior, and that will have its effects in this or future lives. For instance, it is always possible to break through a cycle of revenge or hatred with other people by starting to sow seeds, a way of thinking of a neutral kind. And this will be easier for us if we realize that we are laying the foundations for a better common future for all. Karma has nothing to do with predestination. It is in fact the teaching of free will, of getting a new chance. Thirdly, there's karma that we did produce in former incarnations, but that cannot find a suitable outlet or expression in this life. These karmic seeds lay slumbering in our own consciousness and will awaken someday in a future incarnation when the seeds are ripe and the environment is suitable. To mention a simple example, in this present incarnation, we will not meet all the people with whom we have built up a relationship. And yet, without doubt, they will be our companions in future lives. So when one of our beloved family members or friends dies, we can say with full conviction, see you later. And the stronger your relationship is, the quicker you'll meet again in the next life. So our future is, as you see, directly connected to what we do in the present and what we did in the past. We know a saying that wonderfully summarizes the teaching of karma and reincarnation together, and it is this one. The future does not lay ahead of us, but comes over us as a wave from the past. So, karma teaches us that living is lifelong learning. And how do we learn? By meeting the results of our attempts, of course. Well, just as Herman already said, we often hear talk about so-called positive and negative karma, circumstances that are easy or difficult in our eyes. But we wonder if we really understand karma, whether we would ever use those terms positive and negative karma. Just realize this. How often are our problems in fact wake-up calls? Can we call these problems bad karma when we learn from them? The problems of our lives often stimulate us to develop inner faculties that we ourselves had not expected to possess. They stimulate us to extend our vision, to become milder, and above all, our problems make us more compassionate towards our fellow men, because we see they are facing similar struggles as we experience. Again we ask, how do we learn? And another inspiring conclusion from reincarnation and karma is this: we never learn alone, but always in groups. Why? Because all beings are rooted in the boundless, in universal unity. We are inseparably connected to each other and always will be. So we reincarnate in groups, small and large. We learn by exchanging thoughts, by cooperation, by being each other's teachers and pupils. We may talk about our family or the circle of our friends and enemies, or our town or our country, just what you can imagine, the whole mankind. They are all groups of individuals that incarnate approximately simultaneously, because all the individuals of that group have some attractions in common. They need some evolutionary lessons which are similar. Our individual development is inseparably linked to the development of all group members. So we have a clear responsibility for the whole group. And inner growth is always a mutual process. But it does not mean that we will always incarnate in the same groups. And quite the opposite is true. Our attraction to groups changes, of course, while we evolve. It is a very dynamic process. In each group, there is a continuous flowing in of newcomers and the flowing out of people who gradually feel more attracted to other groups. It's just simply comparable to a normal school. Well, this highly interesting fact that each human being is a member of several groups leads us directly to the third jewel of wisdom that we present to you in this lecture, called the jewel of the hierarchical structure of the universe. The first jewel, reincarnation, teaches us who we are. We are eternal pilgrims, developing our consciousness incarnation after incarnation. The second jewel, karma, teaches us that we choose and direct our own path of learning. It is the doctrine of free will. The third jewel, the hierarchies, teaches us our relation to the cosmos, to all other living beings. It teaches us that we are inseparable parts of a living cosmos, and that the cosmos is built up by beings on different levels of development. That, nevertheless, all those different beings form a unity. All levels are necessary, otherwise the universe would not function at all. Simply, just as in a company or firm, all types, all types of workers are needed. For instance, a planet is in fact a cooperation of divine beings, intellectual beings, astral beings, and physical beings. In fact, a really almost countless number of beings, but all united by one top being or hierarch, which is their divine root. This means that we, human beings, we do not live, as we usually say, on the earth. We live in the earth, in this hierarchy, and mankind is a vital organ in our planet. If mankind does not function well, the whole planet, so to say, will become ill. This hierarchical structure has no bounds or limits. Small hierarchies are parts of greater ones. Simply think about the small living atom in our body, our complete human being, which is a part of a living planet, which is part of a living solar system, which is part of a living galaxy, and now you can continue until your imagination cannot do it anymore. There are lives within lives, hierarchies within hierarchies. But the top of each hierarchy is simply the lowest level of a higher and greater hierarchy, and so on. There are really no limits, according to the old wisdom. They are all interwoven with each other, lives within lives. And in many religions, as you see, this third jewel, this wonderful thought, is symbolized by the tree of life. And when it is pictured well, the roots are at the upper side and the branches at the downside. The tree of life is rooted in the unknown, in boundless life. And the divine stem, the one stem, gives birth to large branches, which produce small branches, and then, of course, little twigs, then the leaves and the flowers. It's easy to understand. Yet, through this immense cosmic tree, when you think about a solar system or a galaxy, this immense cosmic tree flows one life, one consciousness. So each being a part of the tree, is a child of the same universal life. Someone who tries to isolate himself from all other beings, as an individual or as a group, is simply striving for something that cannot exist. We cannot live alone. And brotherhood is, as we say, a fact. It is not an ideal. It is not a vague wish. It is simply a fact. Of course, we human beings are also a branch or a little twig, just how you like to say it, in this tree of life. And that means a lot. That means that it is in fact our duty to transform the stream of consciousness, the stream of wisdom and knowledge flowing from beings wiser than we to beings less wise than we. We are always both teachers and pupils. Teachers we are for all the people who are still struggling with the problems that we already mastered somewhat. And we are always pupils of the many people that can teach us something. And sometimes those people are the same, eh? Teacher and pupil, at different moments, for instance. Furthermore, the teachers, the sages, taught that each being is built up or structured just like the cosmos is. So that's very interesting. We, as a human being, are such a tree too, a little tree. we are a little hierarchy in ourselves. Our spirit, soul, and body parts are the emanations or copies of the spirit, soul, and body part of the complete living cosmos, the cosmos in which we live. So our inner and outer nature as man reflects faithfully the structure of the whole cosmos. That is a wonderful thought, we think. We are children of the cosmos and thus carry all the elements of the cosmos in us. We are a little cosmos, a microcosmos itself, ourselves, and that's why we have intimate relations and connections with all the cosmic planes, from the most divine to the most material. So we are at home everywhere if we would realize it. The most inspiring people we know in our world are always those people who have learned to live in accordance to their higher aspects in their tree of life. They have learned to live in accordance to their own higher nature, their real self. They understand that unity and cooperation are the keys to happiness for all. We know all the examples, Mandela, Gandhi, and also the great spiritual teachers like Gautama the Buddha, Plato, Jesus, Mohammed. But in fact, each unselfish person helps mankind greatly, whether he is publicly known or not. In fact, those people who control their own lower nature, who have mastered their own animal instincts and selfishness, those people are, you may say, the natural leaders, the real leaders of mankind, whether they occupy a high position in our society or not. Now, you must not get the idea of hierarchies as static, frozen structures. Each living being, each hierarchy, has its birth phase, its phase of its greatest strength, and its old age and death phase, as we already found out in the first jewel, the cycle of re-embodiment. And what does that mean, the birth and the growth of a hierarchy? How does that take place? It proceeds from within to without, from its divine core, always stepwise through all the intermediary planes until the most material plane of that hierarchy is activated. And this process, the ancient philosophers called emanation, which means flowing forth from within. Emanation is no creation out of nothing, which in our eyes is impossible. Let us describe emanation in four steps to give you just a general, simple sketch. The top being emanates a field of consciousness. So you can imagine it is a kind of psychomagnetic field from its own consciousness. To this field, less developed beings are attracted, forming an appropriate vehicle or body through which the leading being can express itself. So we see that he attracts beings that were already there, but now find a place within its sphere where they can evolve, and in the same time a new cooperation starts, the higher being and the little lower beings. Now, this is only one step from the divine to the spiritual sphere. This process repeats itself through all the planes until finally the physical plane is reached. And this last step to the physical level we see everywhere around us. For instance, in the appearance and development of a human embryo, an incarnating human soul connects itself by its ray of consciousness to a sperm cell and an egg cell. And after a successful fertilization, the fertilized cell acts as the center of a very strong psychomagnetic field. And that field attracts all the cell entities needed to build up the body. very orderly, fairly structured. Now, this dual wisdom of the hierarchical cooperation of all beings has a lot of consequences. Let us look for a moment at our societies. There, the cosmical hierarchical structure is generally copied in its outer form, but less seldom in its inner true character. Let us explain what we mean. We, in our societies, usually only copy the outer form. Each organization has its leaders and usually is built up of smaller departments that function as a kind of organs within a body. But often is forgotten that each hierarchy should form or is a unity and is also a small part of a greater hierarchy. In fact, all human organizations are inseparable parts of humanity. Consequently, when you think about it, the sole value of an organization lies in its servitude to the interests of all human beings in the world. So, think globally, act locally. Another thought to think about. Each organization has a spirit, a soul, and a body part, and all three should play their appropriate role. A society needs more than material welfare and technical progress, otherwise we stay spiritually hungry. Our deepest needs, they are on the level of understanding the meaning of life. They are on the level of the jewels of wisdom. And the last thought, if we understand this jewel well, we get a completely other idea of leadership than is generally thought. One of the characteristics of a real leader is he serves the interests of all people within his sphere of influence, within his psychomagnetic sphere, and he will understand that every one of those individuals within his organization is equal in intrinsic value. Not that they are not equal in the outer forms, in their outer capacities, no, but in intrinsic value. And that means all human beings are necessary links in the web, and we are just equal in value. Just very simple, but that means that everyone knows that he completely is a necessary part of the organization, just as the director or the greatest boss. Now, we have touched upon the three jewels of wisdom in this lecture. You will have noticed that we cannot separate the jewels of wisdom. They complement each other. And now we can draw some conclusions. Can we influence our next lives? Can we become the masters of our fate? Our incarnations are like the days in our life. Our past days, they define what we may expect tomorrow. Next, we develop our consciousness by the lessons that the law of cause and effect brings us. And each day, each hour, we have the choice to attune our thinking, our consciousness, to the spiritual level of our being, with its unselfish, reforming, and harmonizing influences. Or we may also choose to live in our lowest level, the purely material aims and desires. I think that's a clue. And this does not mean that the material world is morally wrong. It only needs wise direction. We need the inspiration from the spiritual worlds to become masters, not the slaves in this material world, where our duties lie. Cooperation, unity, is the keynote of nature. We can act in harmony with nature, or to try to do the opposite. We can choose. We think the road to active brotherhood and inner peace is choosing to live in unity. But that means we determine now our future by building up harmonious relationships or not. We decide ourselves how the laws of reincarnation, karma, and hierarchies will affect us. We can start a new life each moment, and no effort will be lost. Does inner growth ever stop? What will our future bring? This will be the subject of the lecture in the beginning of the afternoon after the workshop. Thank you very much for the moment. Yeah, before we start the workshops, there may be some questions. We have told a lot, we know. Three viewers at a time. Yes, sir.
Are you talking about it in a literal sense or a figurative sense, meaning charismatic or actual feel that's felt?
Okay. I think it is, you must imagine that what we know as the magnetic fields are also the fields of living beings. So this is also produced by consciousness, but it is only on the physical level that we can measure with our instruments. The scientist can measure a magnetic field, but you can imagine that there are a kind of similar magnetic fields on all levels. The more inner levels of being, and also on the spiritual levels. And in all cases, they are produced by living beings. It is consciousness. And yeah, you can imagine, for instance, that a family living in a kind of house creates a kind of sphere. And when you come in, you usually feel it. It is a kind of sphere, which may be a little bit more harmonious or active, or what all characteristics are possible. So, and that's also within an organization. In fact, the leaders of our organization have more responsibility for the sphere which is within that whole organization. Which tone, which music do they make? Then that will decide what kind of organization it is.
And is this psychomagnetic field also felt between human and animal, and vice versa?
Exactly, effect everywhere. And when you think about it, you can realize that very often animal beings are usually very open to the influence of those kind of magnetic fields. So that's why they somehow seems to know what the boss wants them to do, but they don't listen to your words. They experience it on another way, in an animal way, but yet they know it. So that's true, yeah. But it's also, for instance, there are so many ways. For instance, you can start a new American football club just by saying, we want to start a new club with a special way of dealing the way we train ourselves. For instance, you have a kind of idea of we do it in a very, how do you call it, sportive way, where not winning is not the first goal, but having a nice time together and trying to improve our sport. We like that so much. That's our character. Now, then you can be the core of a sphere, and you will attract all people, I want to do it this way too. And you attract them, you see, from your attraction field. And after a while, you have just a whole team who wishes to do it that way.
So you don't think that they experience it through mental visual images? It's more a feeling?
Yeah. You say it's only feeling. In a certain way, it is also real forces. You can really say that it is influences too, real influences. But you are a free person, and for instance, you can sit in a situation with an influence, but you can always, by your free will, not go with the sphere. Do you understand? You are in a situation and you feel, this is very passive. I don't like that passivity. I remain an active thinker. You can do that. Go opposite to the sphere where you are in. But then you usually do that very purposely. Yeah? Van, no, that's not my method. I do it this way. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. More questions? Okay, then we come to the next slide of the workshops. Now time for you to talk after my long talk. You see here, in fact, the two questions which we like to discuss in small groups so that everyone can lay his egg, as we say in Dutch. First question, can we find examples of the three jewels in our lives? Think about your family life, working life, society, everything is okay. Second, which things become more important and which things become less important in the light of these three jewels? Now, it's very simple. You can hear also explanation by the workshop kind of facilitators. We will have six groups in the room there, and probably that will be enough, I think, six groups, yeah? So there is no need to have here groups. We can all go to the other side. The other way is interesting. We form groups, and then please, when you form a kind of family, and I mean with family not literally, but a kind of theosophical family of other family, just spread, yeah? Spread yourself so that all have their own, influence on all groups. And well, we see each other after 15 minutes here again. We have the harvest of our thoughts then, and we are very curious. So we have 15 minutes now, 45 minutes now, and you will find there at the other room the circles of chairs. Just choose one.